Question. And it goes back to the very core, the very foundation of who we are as followers of Jesus. This is insanely important, and you won't believe how easy it is. As soon as I tell you what the question is, you won't believe, yeah, that is an important question. And it's not hard to drift away from it. Not hard at all. We shouldn't drift away. We can't drift away. But the question is very simply this. What does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be a Christian? And let me ramp it up one more. What does it mean, or why am I a Christian? Why am I a Christian? What does it mean for me? Why am I doing this? Why am I interested in this? Because just literally everything that we get ourselves involved in, whether it be for education, for relationships here, you know, so to speak, and skills and awards and where we live and what we attain, all these things all fit within a period of time called my lifespan. They all fit in there. But the life of the Christian transcends that entire lifespan. In fact, in a great way, it makes the lifespan seem very irrelevant and unimportant. That's how big, that's how important, and that's why we as followers of Jesus, that's why we are Christians, because we know we were created for more than this world. And while we are in this world, we certainly have expectations that we would do, you know, good things, that we would fulfill the purpose of God, that we would live out the purpose that God has for us, that we would be people who make the world a better place within that lifespan. That's all good, and we're supposed to seek the prosperity of our city. All that is important, but that's just a small part. It may be even less than a small part of why we are a Christian. We are Christians because God has given us, through his Son, Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins that he paid on the cross. And in that relationship, by paying the price, we are allowed to have fellowship with God. And in that fellowship, we move from a people who live for the moment, who live for this life, to people who are a people of destiny. And we as Christians, and why are we Christians? Because we are not of this world. Our priorities are not here in this world. We are a people of destiny. We are a people who we admit that we are foreigners and strangers on this earth. We readily admit that. And we understand that sometimes our promises and sometimes our hopes are not fulfilled on this earth. But for us, it's not about this earth, because we are looking for a city, a heavenly city, a heavenly city that God has prepared for us. A heavenly city that God has prepared for us, and as a result, for us who are searching, for us why we are Christians, for us who are living as a person of destiny, as a person who knows who Jesus is, as we live in that, we know that God is not ashamed of us, because indeed, he has prepared a city for us. I like what C.S. Lewis says about heaven. I like what he says about eternity and living with God and a whole new creation on earth. He says, that sounds like a pie in the sky. But if it is a pie in the sky, it literally is a pie in the sky. It is reality. It is true. And it's what God has prepared for us. It's what God has done. And that is so important to our lives as Christians, to remember that it's not only about this life that we live within a time frame, but it's important for us to remember constantly and for us to celebrate and for us to be grateful for that we are a people. We have been chosen to be a person, a people of destiny, where God is taking us somewhere, doing something. But in the midst of all of this, there seems to be this attitude that as we continue in our Christian life, we kind of take our eyes off of Jesus, off of God, and we begin to look at other people, and we begin to say to ourselves in a very subtle way, do you think I'm a Christian? Do you think I am? And it's important for us as followers of Jesus that people around us would say, you're a good person. You've never murdered anybody, right? No, I never have. You're a good person. You are. Right? Okay. And then all of a sudden we begin to get our ideas of what it means to follow Jesus, not anymore from Jesus, but now from those who are around us. The approval and the pats on the back from people around us. And we begin to ask them, and it's just a deafening tone to listening to what God is asking us to do. What is God asking us to be? I think it's a privilege to be here in Evergreen. It's an absolutely beautiful community. But Evergreen is a planned community, and it was designed from the very beginning with the intention that it was going to be a beautiful place, and it's going to be a beautiful place because we're going to make some rules about it. And so when our church purchased this property, the first draft of the architect came out with a building that looked like a church, not a golf club house, but it came out with a beautiful church building. And we took it. They took it down to the city, and the city fathers looked at that planning committee and said, "Oh no, no, no!" You see, because Evergreen has a book that describes everything about it, and this building does not fit in Evergreen. And so you guys are going to have to go back to the architect and change it to meet these requirements. And you guys might not know this, but the houses here are very beautiful, but they're all in one style. There's not a lot of styles of houses. All of our houses, there's a big variety, and they're all gorgeous, but they're all in an architectural style called Southern Mediterranean. And that, yet our church is in a Southern Mediterranean style here. And if you ever wanted to come to Evergreen, because it is a beautiful neighborhood, it's because we do have great schools, and we do have Village Grill. If you wanted to come to Evergreen for all those good reasons, you could come as long as you wanted to live in a Southern Mediterranean style house. You could choose among many, many, many Southern Mediterranean houses, but that's what you'd have to choose from. Those are your choices. And if you would be somebody who says, you know what, I kind of like a modern house, or I like, you know, the old craftsman style house, or, you know, I would like to live in a cape. All these different houses that you could imagine you'd like to live in, nope, not here, not here. No, those are for a different place. That's for a different, if you want to have that, then you need to go somewhere else for that. And so often in our Christian lives, that's exactly what we do. God calls us to be a custom house. God calls us to step up to what His purpose is for us, what He calls us out to be. But it's not very long before we are telling God what the rules are for our lives. Okay, God, I get what you want me to do. I get what you want me to invest my life in, what you want my priorities to be. But let's just go over here what some of the expectations are. And by the time you're done with God, you're back to living in a tract house. You're just kind of fitting into everything. And whatever God asks you to stick out, God has to step up to do something different. Sometimes we're the first ones saying, no, I don't want to stick out. I don't want to stick out. I don't want to be different. I want to be like everybody else, but I want to be among the best of the everybody here. But that's where I want to be. And we do that in our lives. I read about a pastor. It's a very shocking story, but it's a funny story also, I guess, in a sick kind of way, which makes me laugh. This pastor had a young man who came to know the Lord. And this guy had lived a difficult life, a self-destructive life, and drugs, and had been in trouble with the law on many occasions. And he came to the church, and for the first time, he heard about God's love. He had never heard that. He had heard about Jesus. He knew about God, but he didn't know that there was a personal God who loved him individually for who he was. And he said, that's what changed everything in my heart. That's what changed everything in my life is when I learned how much and who God is and how God loves me. As a result of that, he started to read his Bible. He started to spend time in prayer with God, meditation. He started coming to church on a regular basis. He came a part of a small group. Things were just going fantastic for his life. And then the Sunday arrived where the pastor said, hey, everybody wants to be baptized. Let's get baptized. And man alive, he was right in there. He says, I need to get baptized. I want to make who I am known. I'm going to settle this. I want people to know my identity is that I belong to Jesus. And he raised his hand and he got baptized. But in the midst of all getting baptized, as sometimes pastors will do, he was asked to give his testimony. A testimony is a story. Tell me your story. How has God made a difference in your life? And he gave his testimony. He said, man, before I knew Jesus, man, I was a goner. He says, I was going in a really bad direction. Sin had chained me. Sin was holding me back. But it was Jesus that set me free. And I'm here to live my life for him now. And everybody, okay, you know, that's wonderful. That's inspiring for all of us. He got home. And his mother had a different idea. His mother felt that he had kind of gone off the deep end, that he was becoming a fanatic, because she was bothered by this idea of dying to self, of living for Jesus, this idea of picking up your cross and following him. In fact, she was so mad about what her son said during his testimony, because she said, you know, you're not a bad person. You're a good person. You've made some mistakes, but that doesn't mean that you're a bad person, that you're a sinner or anything like that. And she called the pastor up just irate. What are you doing to my son? How are you brainwashing him? I can't believe you want him to become a fanatic. I can't believe the things you're saying to him. I'm calling my lawyer in the morning, and he's going to sue you. Yeah, he's going to sue you. Well, evidently her lawyer changed his number because she never called. But the sentiment is there. And that pastor was thought, wow, that's really rough to have a mom like that discouraging him. So what he did was he called the young man, and the young man didn't answer. So he waited a few days, and he called again. And again, the young man didn't answer his phone. Waited till the next week. He didn't come to church on Sunday. Waited till the next week, called. And this time, the young man answered the phone. But this is what he said this time. He said, you know, he says, I'm grateful for everything that happened. I'm glad that I'm out of that old lifestyle, but I don't want to go crazy. I want to be, you know, I want to be a good person, but I don't want to do anything weird. And I just want to be me. I'm going to come to church. I'm going to come back to church. But that's what I want. I don't want to step out in any way. And the pastor saw that there's another one that bit the dust. Another one that was lost to the kingdom of God. Somebody who just wanted to be normal. Just wanted to have the comforts. You know, wanting comfort in life and wanting to follow Jesus is an oxymoron. You're going to have to make the decision. You're going to make your choice. Am I going to follow Jesus, or am I going to live a life of comfort? That's the reality of it. That's what God calls us to. And when God puts that in our hearts, when the Holy Spirit reveals to us, what does that mean in my life and the decisions that I have to make? What are the changes that I have to make? You know what? God's looking at that and saying, hey, this is how I'm going to help you. This is how I'm going to help change your heart. And this is what I hope to give you as a result. This is where I'm leading you to. And in the midst of all that, we sometimes have somebody, maybe they're not in our own house, maybe they are. Or maybe it's a collection of people, or maybe it's a particular person that is important in our lives. And they're discouraging you from giving your life of living for Jesus. They have their own ways. They know you very well. They know your trigger points. And they do that. That's hard to overcome. That's a rough one. But today, we're going to baptize somebody today. And I would like to give you this opportunity that if you have come to know Jesus in your heart, and you are in a place where you say, you know, I have not made a public profession or a public demonstration of my faith in Jesus. I'm going to live for him. You know what? Today would be the day for you. And I'd encourage you as when we close out the service, you don't have to bring anything. We have the package that has towels and swim trunks and T-shirts. We have everything for you, everything, hair dryers, blah, blah, blah. We got everything for you. So after the service, if this is something that God's put in your heart, don't miss this opportunity. Don't miss this opportunity. There's a reason you're here. There's a reason God is speaking to your heart. And if this is a step that you need to take, then take this step. This is God revealing his presence to you. This is what God is doing and saying in your heart. I'm going to share a verse, and it's found in Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, and it's verses 37 through 39. And in this passage that we're going to read, specifically these verses, it's kind of jarring. It's kind of bothersome. And it's just not normal at all. It's calling us to a whole different type of life. And this is Jesus. And it's hard for us sometimes to think of Jesus as somebody who says, you got to step it up a lot. You've got to really make some decisions in your life. You've got to decide which way are you going to go. Who are you going to live for? You really got to come to this moment, you know, we got to define the relationship moment, the DTR, define the relationship. We got to come to this spot where we say, this is how my life is going to be. This is the direction it's going to go in. And this is what Jesus is saying. He talks about the relationships with our parents. He talks about the relationships with our children. And his point here is, very simply, he says all those are important. And Jesus says a lot about loving our parents and our children and our neighbors. He says a lot about these. He's not saying that. But he's saying, in comparison to me, in comparison to my central place in your life, everything else must take a distant second. And this is where we pick up here in verses 37 from Matthew chapter 10. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it. And whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. Isn't that a strange verse? Isn't that a strange verse? Because Jesus has taken the things that are so important in our lives and at the very center of our lives, and the things that we're told, this is what life is about. This is the very best of life. When these relationships are on all fours, when they're just tracking and everything's going perfect, this is as best as you can get. When we have enough money to meet your needs and to do the things that you like to do, when all these things are going well, when all these things are working for you, Jesus is saying, I want you to just move it off the table. I want you to move it off the table, and I want you to move me into the center of your life. And it's hard. It's like, what are you talking about? I thought you're supposed to make everything better. And here Jesus is challenging us, no, not really to make everything better, to make you and me better. To bring you and me into the relationship. Make that. And then watch as everything else revolves around that and feeds from that and is resourced from that relationship. But that I would be at the very center, that I would have that. So many of us, we get into this mode of, you know, all I need to do is be like Jesus. Do what Jesus would do. And it's very easy to do those things, to check them off, and to forgive people like Jesus would forgive people, and to be generous like Jesus would be generous, and to help, and to volunteer, and to be patient with people. Check, 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 check. It's so easy to do those things in between living like Jesus to living for Jesus, to living for Jesus. If I asked you, hey, would you do something? I want you to do it like me, like I do it. Will you watch how I do it, and then I want you to do it? And you say, yeah, no problem. I can do that. But Jesus doesn't ask us to be like him in that sense. What he asks us is for us to live for him. And so what Jesus is saying to you and to me is very simple. It's a huge challenge. You say, would you live for me? Not for your family. Would you not live for your career? Would you not live for what the opinions of other people are for you? Would you not live for your dreams and for your aspirations and for your education, what your mother's expectations were? Would you not live for all of those? And just move them to the side and put me at the center of your life. And would you live for me? Would you live for me? That's what Jesus is asking you and me. Would you live for me? And he challenges us in that area. He challenges us, and he calls us to really examine what does it mean to live for him. And the first thing I would say is to share with you is that when we live for him, again, it's not something we do. You don't fall into the same trap of living like him when you live for him. In fact, living for him is very little about what you do and a whole lot to do with who you are, where your heart is, and where your identity is, and who you are as a follower of Jesus. Who you are as a follower of Jesus. So that your identity is no longer your profession or what you do at work. Your identity is no longer your ethnicity or language you speak. Your identity is no longer your value to other people or how people size you up. Your identity is no longer being a failure. Your idea is no longer being an addict. Your identity is no longer being somebody that isn't good to be around. No. Your identity now gets all those moved to the side, and your identity is now a child of God. I belong to Jesus. Jesus is mine, and I am Jesus's. We now have a new identity to who we are. And when anybody looks at us and talks to us, if they would talk to us very long, they would quickly say, this person is a little bit different. This person is not living like I live. This person has a different set of priorities. And at some point, maybe, somehow, some way, somebody would begin to say, you know, that person is not living for themselves. That person is living for something else. And at some point, maybe it would come out that they are living for Jesus. And there would be no doubt in your own heart. And then in comparison to all the things you could be living for, you're not, because your identity is, I belong to Jesus. I live for Jesus. I am a child of God. And I am not a child of God just for this lifespan, but I am a child of God for all of eternity. God has a plan for my life, not only for this world, but for all of eternity. That's who I'm connected with. That's where I am. That's where I find who I am. That's who I identify. That's my identity. That's who I am. You know, when and sometimes we get into these questions, and I want to share with you, just to help clarify some of these, a good question to ask, a fair question to ask, maybe I should say, is a very simple question, and that is Jesus enough for you? Is Jesus enough? If you can come to the point in your life where you can say, yes, I don't always live like that, and I don't always show it, and it's not always my decisions, but I want you to know that between me and Jesus, he knows where my heart is that I realize and I know that deep inside, Jesus is enough. That if I had nothing in this world but I had Jesus, I would have all that I would ever need and all that I would ever want. I know that that potential is, I know that relationship is there. I know that that's what I could live for. If I can come to that moment where I know that Jesus is all I need, that's where I want to be. That's what I want to do. You know, somebody that can say Jesus is all I need from the most honest spot in their heart, in all sincerity, the person who can say that is somebody who is living for Jesus. Somebody who's living for Jesus. When you're able to say, I don't need that. I don't need the money. I don't need the relationships. I don't need the fame. I don't need the awards. I don't need people thinking well of me. I don't need, what I need is Jesus. I don't need people not, you know, I can't have people criticizing. No, it's okay if they criticize. I don't need their approval. What I need is Jesus. When you find yourself in that moment where you can say that with sincerity, you're living for Jesus. I want to share three more questions that really get at the heart of who are you living for. And I want to challenge you also with these questions that you've already made the decision, yes, I'm going to live for Jesus. If you've already made that decision, you know what? It's good to ask yourself these questions and ask the Holy Spirit to put his finger somewhere in your life that it's not aligned right. So these questions are very simple. Questions to ask living for God is number one, does God control your time? Does God control your time? How do you spend your time? Are you spending it all for Jesus in ways that he endorses, that he would approve? Things that he's saying, yes, that's kind of necessary. You should spend your life in those things. Spend your time. Because sometimes what we do is we say, I'm going to give this much time to God, and the rest of it, well, that's my business. That's how I live my life. Well, that's not living for Jesus. That's not living for Jesus at all. The person who lives for Jesus, all of their time, 100% of their time belongs to Jesus. And they live their time, they live out their time for Jesus. The second question isn't very different from this. Does God control how you spend your money? I know we talk about giving a tithe, 10% of your income. And a lot of times we might do that and we might say, see, yes, if he didn't, I sure wouldn't be tithing. I do that in a worship, in a praise of him. Yes, that's why I tithe. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the 90%. the part that you haven't designated and given it back to God, it's His. But the rest of it, the 90%, how does He control how that is spent? In what ways are that being spent? Is it being spent in response to a life that's living for Him? Is that how it's being spent? And it doesn't have to be big amounts, it could be tiny amounts too. But the question is the same. Does He control how you spend your money? And then the third question is like the first two, but it's a little bit harder. Does He control your thought life? Does He control your thought life? Where do your thoughts go? What are the things that you say? What are the things that you ultimately spend time thinking about and caring about or occupied with or obsessed with? Are those in control of God? Are those the thoughts that come from a person who made a decision to live for Jesus? Are they? Are they those thoughts of a person? Oh, I tell you, that's when we're able to truly learn to live an expansive life where we truly live for Him in all areas of our lives and we surrender these areas to Him. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. A lot of times we say, what am I going to miss out on? What am I going to lose? What am I not going to have if I live for Jesus other than living for myself? What would I miss in this world? I don't know. Try to think of something. It's not that easy. Because anything you're going to live for, the Grim Reaper is going to take right away from you. We got to come back and we got to say, Lord, do something in my heart. By your Holy Spirit, help me to live out this commitment to live for you. To have a vision for eternity and be who you call me to be. The danger is not living a life that is surrendered to God, a life that puts God in first place, puts God in the center of your life. That's not the danger. The danger is not living a life where God is the center, where God is in first place, where God is not being lived for. We are not living for God entirely. That's the danger. That's the danger. As we close here and as we come to this song, I would like to just challenge you to look deep inside your heart. Is this a moment that God has brought you to challenge you, to have you reconsider and have to maybe rededicate or resurrender your life? Is this a moment where God is saying, hey, I'm glad we're thinking about this. How about this area? How about this? How about this type of thinking? How about this type of time? How about this type of spending? What about here? And if we would welcome God's input, if we would welcome God's direction, as we do, as we are following Jesus as Christians, as we do, open it up and say, yes. Yes, Lord, you have your way in me. Yes, my answer to anything you say, God, is yes. My answer to following you, putting you at the center of my life is yes. It's an unequivocal, unconditional yes. That's where I am, Lord. Let that be. And if at this time you're somebody who says, you know, I have made that decision. I make the decision now. And I want to follow Jesus. And I want the world to know. I want to make that sign. And I want that experience of publicly being baptized before God. Then you know what? This is a good day for you. And while we sing the song, I invite you to just walk out and walk into the lobby. And there's somebody there with everything you're going to need, a bag for you to be baptized with. And then they'll lead you through that. And then you'll come back out and we'll all gather together and watch the people be baptized and praise God for that. That's where we are. But let this song be a prayer. And let this song be a call of your life. And let your response be yes, Lord, to what God is calling you to.